gospel on this morning to the NFC Championship game. Minnesota Vikings is for Mark, chapter 1, verses 14 through 20. Glory to you, Lord. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." So as Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And as he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boats, mending the nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. And you may be seated. If you know somebody's favorite place or their favorite ground, where they like to hang out, then you know something very critical about them. You know something very important about that person. If you know where they like to be, where they're comfortable being. And I know some of you have been to Lake Bend, the town that I grew up in. And so when you travel into Lake Bend from the north, as you would coming from Dawson on Highway 75, you have to go up a little hill, and when you get to the crest of that hill, you can look down into the valley of Lake Bend. And you can see actually across to the other side where there's also a hill, and it actually says on the hill Lake Bend, and there's a little cross there as well to welcome you as you come into town from the north. But it doesn't matter which direction you come into town. If you come in from the east, you go up a hill too. When you get to the crest of the hill, you can look down into the valley where the town is nestled, or if you come in from the west, the same. You have an incline in Highway 14, and then you get to the top of the hill, and you can see the lake that welcomes you and the other hills, all in the mountain park that surrounds you. And so, whenever I was away from home, from Lake Bend for a while, if I was off to college and my schedule was dictated by the mean professors who made me study and read, where my whole schedule was dictated by what they wanted me to learn, and I finally was on break, and I could leave that behind, and I would travel home, and I would come in from the east, and I would get to that top of the hill, and when I would get to the top of the hill, I would look down into the town, and I would just start breathing a little easier. My heart would stop pounding, so because I was home. That was the place that I was comfortable being. And we had a friend that lived in Barrow, Alaska, and she taught school there. And she always talked about the cold and the crystal clear nights and the stars that seemed just to kind of hang there so close that you could almost like reach up and grab those stars. And she said that place became home to her. It was a place that just she was able to rest, and it just calmed her heart. And many of you know that my wife Emily, she grew up on the coast, and so she talks often of being on the ocean shore, on the sand, and you know, having her feet and toes kind of rubbing through the sand of the shore. And she talks about the smell of the ocean, the smell of the salt water. And there was just something about that smell and the sight of the ocean that was calming for her. It was a restful place for her. And you know this too, maybe here in Dawson. Maybe it's when you get to the stoplights just west of town and you can see the lights of Dawson just out in the distance, and you maybe have been gone for a while, and you just breathe a little easier because you know you'll be home soon, right? Or maybe you're coming in from the south and you get to the Moore Hill. I don't know if they call it the Moore Hill, but do they call it the Moore Hill? I don't think so, but you know what I'm talking about, right? And you go down start breathing a little easier. Maybe you just calm yourselves a little more. If you know someone's favorite ground, or if you know someone's favorite place, then you know what is important to them. You know things that are critical about them. And I'm convinced that Jesus' favorite place was the Sea of Galilee. He grew up in the Galilean town of Nazareth, and you know this. Nazareth was a day or two walk to the west of the Sea of Galilee. And when Jesus began his ministry, he moved east and relocated from Nazareth in the hill country to the seaside town of Capernaum. And I'm not sure why he did that. It could have maybe something to do with how the people in his town reacted to the start of his ministry there. His hometown congregation, the Bible tells us, rioted and wanted to kill him after he preached his first sermon there. So maybe Jesus was just a little uncomfortable, right, in his hometown. Or maybe it could be that Jesus felt the people of Capernaum were more receptive to what God was doing through him. Or maybe it was just that place, Capernaum, by the lake. Maybe that was just Jesus' place. Maybe that's the place where he just liked to hang out. That was his place. In many of the stories of the Gospels, Jesus is either near the lake or he's on the lake. He always seems to be getting into a boat or sailing in a boat or getting out of a boat. And you can really do kind of a geographical lesson on the work and the ministry and the miracles of Jesus around the Sea of Galilee. On the eastern side of the lake at 3 o'clock in the town of Gergesa, where Jesus healed a demon-possessed man and sent the demons into a herd of pigs. You remember that story? At 9 o'clock, if you're picturing the Sea of Galilee, about 9 o'clock on the western shore is the town of Magdala, and it is known for its fishing industry, where salt was used to preserve fish, and we also know it was the home of Mary Magdalene. And her life was a mess, the New Testament tells us. Problems on top of problems, demons on top of demons, the Bible says, and then God's love and grace came to her in a compelling way, and she was changed. Everything changed for her. She became one of Jesus' most devoted followers, a close friend, and a living witness of the power of God and of God's grace and truth, active and alive in people's lives. And then at 11 o'clock on the western shore, on the northwestern corner of the Sea of Galilee, is Capernaum. And that is where Jesus taught. It's where he healed the mother-in-law of Simon Peter, where he healed the centurion of a Roman officer, and where he raised the daughter of Jairus from the dead. And then very close to there, about 11:30 on the Sea of Galilee, at the very northwestern corner of the lake, is the traditional place where Jesus is to have preached his most famous sermon, where they did try to kill him, at least at that point, the Sermon on the Mount, right on the Sea of Galilee. And then finally, just east of the Jordan River in the north, across the Capernaum, is Bethsaida, where Jesus healed a man who had been born blind. That's where Jesus fed also the crowd of 5,000 people, not including women and children. You remember that miracle story as well. Feeding over 5,000 people with a few loaves of bread and a couple of fish. So if you were to sail around the Sea of Galilee past the places where these towns are used to being, it would be a powerful reminder of the life and the ministry of Jesus. Because if you know someone's favorite ground or place, then you know something that's very important to them. The Sea of Galilee and the hills and the towns surrounding surrounding it, that was Jesus' ground. That's where Jesus lived. That was his place. And so there on the Sea of Galilee, Jesus calls his first disciples and says to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." I wonder what James and Andrew thought, and John and Peter thought about those words of Jesus. "We're fishermen. How in the world are we going to fish for people? What kind of bait are we going to use now? We know what bait to use to fish for fish, but what kind of bait are we going to use to fish for people? And what in the world does that mean? What kind of nets are we going to have to cast out to fish for people? Will we cover people with salt like we do with fish and lay them out in the sun to dry? Is that what Jesus is talking about here?" So in all of their questions, even beyond their curiosity, they knew this one thing. That when they were around this Jesus of Nazareth, when they were around this teacher, there was something about their life that changed. There was something about their life that was different when they lived in and around with this Jesus. Just like the life of folly will now be changed because of Jesus living in and around him. And just like our lives are different because we have this Jesus that has called us, and that this Jesus that lives with us and around us, our lives are different. When you know someone's favorite ground or place, you know something important about them. And so this story speaks to us. This story speaks to me. This story should speak to you. Let me tell you what I hear this story saying to me and to us. First, it is true that Jesus has a way of showing up where we are. Jesus has a way of showing up to the important places in our lives where we're comfortable and where we live and where kind of our heart just rests. Jesus has a way of showing up in those places to call us to something greater. To maybe even in our restful hearts, that Jesus calls our hearts to be a little restless. That Jesus calls us to do something. That Jesus calls us to follow him in the places where we are, in the places where we've grown so comfortable in. Jesus calls us to do something great. Jesus calls us to proclaim God's love, to proclaim God's grace where we're at. Jesus shows up in those comfortable places. So my question for you is, where is Jesus showing up in your comfort zone and calling you out to once again renew your following of him? Where have you not followed Jesus well in your life? Where could you be better at following Jesus? These are important questions for us. Jesus comes to us because if you know someone's favorite place or ground like Jesus does, then you know something important about them. So Jesus shows up when Simon Peter and the others are at work around the lake. For with Jesus you are never safe from being found. Jesus will find you and Jesus will call you to something. What we say around here is that if you're not dead, then Jesus is not done with you. If you're not dead, then you're not done. Are you dead? Then you're not done. Jesus is not. Maybe we need to say that, right? And you've said it before. I'm not dead. So I'm not done. I'm not dead. So I'm not done. Jesus is calling you to something great. Jesus has a way of showing up where we are to call us, even in our favorite places, even if we are certain that we are beyond the reach of God, that right in the middle of our comfort zone, Jesus shows up and calls us where we are and calls us to follow Him. Now, if you know someone's favorite ground or place, you know something important about them, right? Have you got that? Have you got that this morning? Sure, you've got that this morning. So, in our places that are important to us, that's where we meet Jesus. And Jesus is always about showing up in our favorite places and inviting Him to follow. God uses you to change the world. God wants to stretch you. God wants to stretch you in your spiritual life. God wants to stretch you in your life of service to others. So God will show up to use you to change the world. Because that's the way. That's the way to a deeper and richer and more vital life that God in Christ is calling each of us. So this teacher from Nazareth, who loves being on the beach, who loves being on the water, says, there's nothing to fear. Who loves being in your favorite places and says, there's nothing to fear. Follow me. You'll be fishing for people. And that sounds like something that we can do, right? That sounds like something that we can do together, each and every one of us. Amen? Soul?